מסכת בחורות, פרק שמיני בשעה טובה. Thank God we start the 8th chapter. We are on page 46 at the Mishnah. We are going to zoom in the halachot of firstborn of a person. There are two important categories when it's come to a firstborn. First is the redemption of the firstborn. Second is the double portion, which the Torah expands with the idea that the person needs to leave for his firstborn double portion. Obviously, there are many questions involved with different situations, such as previous marriages, such as miscarriages, and many more. So let's start. Yesh bechor lenachala ve'ino bechor lechohen. So, as we said, since we talk about two halachot when it's come to a status of women's, women have a firstborn baby, boy, and we have the pidyon haben, the obligation after 30 days to redeem the firstborn son from a kohen, and the second one, as we said, is the right to receive a double portion, a differs from all the other sons or children in a sense of inheritance. So the definition of the firstborn, it's one of those things that need to be discussed, because the Torah said, quote, Deuteronomy 21, for he is the first of his strength, the right of the firstborn is his. So even if his mother bore other sons from a previous husband, he is still considered the firstborn of his father. And nevertheless, we derive Gemara and Bava Batra, page 111b, they tell us that not every son born first to a man is a firstborn. So the Mishnah tells us that there is a son who is a firstborn when it's come to inheritance, meaning that he received the double portion, as the Torah said in Deuteronomy 21, Mishpat HaBchorah, but he is not in a category of a firstborn with regard to the requirement of redemption from a Kohen. That's the five Sla'im. Also, Bechor LaKohen Ve'ino Bechor LeNachala. So you have a firstborn when it's come to regard to the redemption from a Kohen, but he's not firstborn when it's come to inheritance. Bechor lenachala velakohen, some case that have both inheritance and the redemption, then a redemption is from a Kohen. Veyesh eino bechor, and there are cases when there is not a firstborn at all, lo lenachala velo lekohen, neither with regard to inheritance, not with regards to redemption from a kohen. So now we go to each of the category. Ezehu bechor lenachala veino bechor lekohen. Give me a case when your baby boy, the son, he is firstborn with regards to inheritance, but he's not the firstborn when it's come to redemption from a Kohen. So if you have a male boy that came, Haba Achar Nephalim, that he came after the mother miscarriage of undeveloped fetus. Rashi expand on that, we just go a little bit. He said, Sheyatza Rosho Shel Nefel Chai, the head came out of a undeveloped baby. Kigon shehayu teomim, it's like they have a twin. Echad nefel ve'echad kalu lo chodashav. Meaning you have a twin, one is nefel and one is kalu lo chodashav, ve'otzi nefel rosho chai ve'echziro ba chavero ve'kidmo ve'yatza ze'acharon b'chor l'nachalad rishon lo efsido. So Rashi here brings an example of haba achar nefalim, one who came after miscarriage of the undeveloped fetus, af al pi sheyatza et rosho chai, even where the head of undeveloped fetus emerged alive, uben tisha sheyatza rosho met, or after a fully developed 9 month old fetus whose head emerged dead, hamapelet kemin beema chaya va'ov divrei Rav Meir, or unfortunate miscarriages, such as woman miscarried a fetus that had the appearance of type of domesticated animal, undomesticated animal, a bird, or that is considered the opening of the womb. That's the view of Rabbi Meir. V'chachamim omrim ad sheyehevo mitzurat adam. So the sages hold, the son is not exempted from the requirement of redemption from a Kohen, unless his birth follow the birth of an animal that takes the form of a person. So there are few explanations like the Rambam and few others that speaks about the exact graphic, how that can be, but anyway, Hamapelet sandal, one woman who miscarriages a fetus in a form of a sandal fish, or shilya, or from whom and after birth, or shafir merukam, or gestational sac, vayotzem mechutach, or the one who emerged is unfortunate in pieces, haba achareihem b'chol l'nachala v'en b'chol l'kohen. The son who follows this is a firstborn with regard to inheritance, but is not a firstborn with regard to redemption from a Kohen. From a Kohen, from a priest, yes. Now, it's important to know that there is a lot of rabbinic writing on this. I'll just give you a little bit. Here is the Rambam. The Rambam in Ilchot Nachalot, chapter 2. If the head of a fully developed 9 month old fetus emerged dead and then returned to the womb, the subsequent son is a firstborn with regard to inheritance, but is not a firstborn with regard to redemption of a firstborn, as he did not open his mother's womb. You see it also in Yoedea 3:05. Mi shelo ayu lo banim venasa isha shekvar yalda, someone who so far has no sons, and he married women that already prior to that already have children, gave birth. Or if he married a woman who gave birth when she was still a, in those days they have Knanite maid servants. Benasa isha shekvar yalda oda veshivcha venishtachrera, oda nochrit venitgaira, she was a non-Jew and she converted to Judaism, meaning gave birth was still is a non-Jew and she converted, which nowadays you see cases like that. Mishebat li Israel yalda, come to Jewish people, she gave birth to a male, b'chol en achalav en b'chol akwen, so it's considering a firstborn when it's come to law of inheritance, yet is not a firstborn when it's come to redemption from a Kohen. Rabbi Yossi Glili omer, b'chol nachalav la Kohen, is both firstborn with regard to inheritance and regard to redemption of from a Kohen. Sheneemar, because Torah said in Exodus 13 verse 2, Peterechem b'Israel, excuse me, whatever opens the womb among the children of Israel. So you have here clear indication that the halachic status of a child born to the mother and is not that of one who opens the womb, unless ad sheifteru rechem Israel, unless it opens the womb of a woman from the Jewish people. Mi she'elu banim v'nasa isha shelo yalda, one who have sons and married women who had not give birth, or if he married a woman who converted while she was pregnant, nitgayra mu'uberet, nishtachrera mu'uberet, or if you talk about Canaanite maid servant who was emancipated, which means they became free while she was pregnant and she gave birth to a son, he is a firstborn with regard to redemption from a Kohen, as he opened his mother's womb. However, he is not firstborn when it's come to law of Nachalot, when it's come to inheritance, because he is not the firstborn of his father, or because halachically he has no father. V'yalda hig v'chohenet, or Israelit woman, and the daughter or wife of a Kohen, neither of whom had give birth yet, or a Israelit woman and the daughter or wife of a Levi, he ulviya, he ve'isha shekvar yalda, v'chen mishelo sha'ata l'achar bala shlosha chodeshim, as we learned many times. Very important requirement is to, after a woman either lost her husband or divorced from requirement is 3 months, make sure that it's 92 days after that she is not pregnant with the, nowadays we have DNA, but still, that's the halachic requirement. Make sure that it's a child from the new one. So if it happens that she did not wait 3 months after the death of her husband, and she married and gave birth, and it's unknown whether the child was born after a pregnancy of 9 months, and is the son of the first husband, or whether he was born after the pregnancy of 7 months and is the son of the later husband. So in all these cases, when he said, so this is the case that you have the category of halakha as a firstborn with regard to redemption from a Kohen. However, it's not the firstborn when it's come to inheritance, because we have such a situation of ambiguousness. It's so uncertain, so he is unable to prove he is the firstborn of either father, and therefore he is not entitled to double portion of the firstborn. You see more in Choshen Mishpat, in Yoredea 305 and 277, as well as the Rambam, Ilchot Nachalot, chapter 5. Obviously, we cover Mamesh really the very basic. There is a way more to discuss this, so let's go to our Gemara. 46b. So, what do we understand from the Mishnah? That when the head comes out, the head of the fetus emerged and then went back into the womb, the offspring is not considering as have been born. So Amar Shmuel en Arosh Poter bin Falim. So as a result, since came out and back, it's not exempt the next fetus from the obligation of redemption of the firstborn, which is if its twin brother was born first. And they have more on that in the Mishnah in Nida 28, but Amar Shmuel en Arosh Poter bin Falim. So Shmuel says that the halacha specifically in the case of miscarriage, where the fetus whose head emerged was stillborn and the one that was the fetus whose head emerged was still born and eventually born after is a viable offspring. However, in a case where both are viable offspring, that emergence of the head is considered birth. Maitama, the reason for that. So if you look at the pasuk, at the verse in the book of Genesis, Bereshit chapter 7, verse 22, the pasuk said, Kol asher nishmat ruach hayim be'apav. All in whose nostrils was the breath of the spirit of life. So what do you derive from that? Kol heichad de nishmat ruach hayim be'apav hu dechashiv reishe idach lo chashiv reishe. Anywhere that one has the breath of the spirit of life, which is, if it is viable, one goes by its nostrils, which is its head, is considered significant. However, with regard to another offspring, one that is not viable, its head is not considered a significant. Tnan. Now the Gemara challenge from the Mishnah on the view of Shmuel. If you have a baby, it's a fetus, it is a son, Haba achar nefalim, who came after the miscarriage of an undeveloped fetus. Sheyatza rosho chai, so the head of the undeveloped fetus emerged alive. Uben tisha, sheyatza rosho met. And you have a fully developed 9-month-old fetus whose head emerged dead. So even the Mishnah addressed a 9-month-old fetus as well. Katane miha rosho. In any event, they teach us when it comes to a miscarriage that its head exempt the offspring born after. Mai rosho, rubo. What is the meaning of the term its head? It means its head and most of the body. So the Gemara asks, velitnei rubo. So the Mishnah needs to say most of it. My respondent said, "Bedinu dib elei lemitne rubo." So the Mishnah actually should have said most of it. However, ve'aide de kabay lemitnei seifa ben tishah sheyatza rosho met. So since the last part of the Mishnah, the seifa, you need to teach a fully developed 9-month-old fetus whose head emerged dead. Tama de roshomet. The reason that the next baby that was born afterward and he turned to be Bechol and Achala, firstborn for the inheritance, it's because the head of the first one came out dead. Ha rosho chai, but if the head emerged, of that fetus head emerged as alive, haba acharav b'chol enachala nam elohavei, the next fetus, the next baby that comes out, even the second one, which is the firstborn for inheritance, doesn't have that category. So therefore, tana reisha nam erosho. So therefore, the Tana of the Mishnah taught in the first clause that the head of a miscarriage exempt the subsequent son. So basically, that's like bring the same style, the same way, all the way. Now, Tosfot hold that you can derive that from both, from Reisha and the Sefer. But anyway, there is a book called Korban Hashem and Mitzpeh Etan and more that expand on that. Maika Mashmalan. So if you follow this idea, what is the Mishnah teaching us? When the Mishnah used the term Rosho, head, if the Mishnah meant to say the Kheivan de Mapikle Reishi Havaleida. So it's once the offspring reached out its head from the womb, it's considering a birth. Now, which means the head came out alive, literally. That's the way Rashi explained. So it's already under the category of delivering a child, the Leida. It can be. Why? Tanina. That's Gemara in Chulin 68. Mishnah. That said, when you have an animal that have a difficulty to deliver its fetus, Hotzi Rosho, Aval Bishech Ziro Areze Kealud, if you have an animal, have very hard time to deliver the fetus, and that fetus of the animal have the heads came out, even that head came back to the mother's womb, we hold the category of that fetus as the firstborn, whose consumption is permitted only by its own slaughter. So why the Mishnah needs to teach us this din, this law? V'chi teima. And if you tell me that the Mishnah speaks about a fetus, that the heads come out, Ashmuinan be'ema v'kamashmelan be'adam. So you tell me that you learn it from animals. And the Mishnah here teaches that the same halacha applies to human. It's not resolved this difficulty. So first the Gemara explained why two rulings might be necessary with regard to people and animals. The Adam mi behema lo yalif, that human cannot be derived from an animal. Why? The late lepos, though, the animal has no concealed opening. The opening of an animal womb is no hidden. So as a result, one might have thought that only in the case of an animal is the emergence of the head considered a birth. However, in humans, where the woman's thighs conceal the opening of the womb, and the emergence of the head alone is not noticeable. So you may think that the emergence of the head is not considered a full-fledged birth. Be'ima me'adam lo yalfa. On the other hand, had this ruling and thought with regard to humans. So you can say that the halacha of animals cannot be derived from that of a human because the countenance of a person's face is significant. Mishum dechashev partzuf pnim didei. Usually, if you remember the Mishnah in Yevamot 120, they said that the head and the recognition of people and the human, it's go by the head. So as people, we are created in the image of God. It's not when it's come to animals. Hana metanina yatza kedarko. We learn it in the Mishnah Nida 28. If the human baby came out, the fetus emerged in the usual manner, which is head first, it's considered only mishiyatza rov rosho. When you call it nolad, when the majority of the heads of that fetus came out, vezeu rov rosho, and what exactly consider most of his head. So they said mishiyatza padachto, when the forehead emerges. So there is no need for the Mishnah here to state the halakha with regard to the head of a nine-month-old fetus and the mention of a head with regard to a miscarriage contradicts the opinion of Shmuel. Tiuvta de Shmuel Tiuvta. It's refutation of the view of Shmuel, because the Shmuel said that the head ein arosh poter binfali. And that's when you remember when they repeat the word Tiuvta twice, is a total refutation. In Yoredea, the Tur in Shulchan Aruch, Yoredea Shin Hei, they said if the forehead of a human offspring emerged, the offspring considered born with regard to all matters. So if you go by the Kesef Mishneh and the Bedek Abayit and the Rambam, Ilchot Nachalot chapter 2 and Ilchot Bikurim chapter 11, so the same halacha applies if the majority of its forehead emerged. Consequently, if an eight-month-old fetus reached out its forehead while it's still alive, or if a nine-month-old was dead when it reached out its foreleg, it's exempt the subsequent son from the redemption of the firstborn. Similarly, Shulchan Aruch said, if a nine-month-old reached out its foreleg and then brought it back, and subsequently his brother was born, the first one is considered the firstborn with regard to inheritance. Let's follow the principle in Halakha that we follow the view of Rabbi Yochanan who disputes Reish Lakish. Omar Rabbi Shimon ben Lakish. So here we talk about the forehead, the Metzach, that's considering Leida. Rabbi Shimon Padachat put. Teret b'chol makom. He said the moment that you have emergence of the forehead, that's, if it's come along, it's in a case of a person exempt, it's considered a birth. In all cases, chutz min hanachala, except from the law of inheritance. If a son reached out his head alone and then brought it back, after which a twin brother was born, the second brother is the firstborn with regard to inheritance. My Tama, because the Torah said in Dvarim 21, verse 17, the word Yakir Amar Rachmana. So it means that it's recognized, the firstborn. Rabbi Yochanan Amar Afilu Nachala. Rabbi Yochanan says, even with regard to inheritance, the emergence of a forehead is sufficient. Bechol Makom La'atu Yemai. In all cases, what that's the comprehensive phrase served to include. La'atuya had a tanu rabbanan. Giyoret shiatz'a padachat vlada biyota begeyuta, biyuta nochrit. Ve'achar kach nidgaira. So you have a female convert whose offspring reach out its forehead along in her gentle state, and then she converted and gave birth to the entire child. Einot nimla yemei tum'a v'yemei ta'ara ve'ina makriva korban leida. So we do not assign to her the days of ritual impurity and the days of ritual impurity of a Jewish woman who gave birth, and likewise she does not bring the offering that woman is obligated to offer after giving birth, as the child is considered to have been born while the mother was still a non-Jew. Meitive. As we said, that it's much to discuss. Rashi here said that, biblically speaking, the category like that doesn't carry a tumat nida, ziva, leida. But as we said, that this subject is a lot of expansion. My brother-in-law, God bless him, Rav Duvin Avraham Mandelbaum, in Daf al Daf, expand on this sugya a lot. See also Tosfot in Nida 36. Meitivei, they challenge Rabbi Yochanan from a Braita. Yakir, when we said about Bechor, bring a source from Dvarim 21:17, he shall recognize. Zo hakarat panim, that's applied to recognition of the face. Ve zoi hakarat panim, what exactly you meant to say when you talk about recognition of the face? Partzuf panim im hachotem. That applies what? The recognition of the face with the nose, which means you have indication that the forehead alone is insufficient. Tanei ad achotem. So now we repair this braita in order to fit the view of Rabbi Yochanan. So we learn the braita, it means ad achotem. Ad, up to, but not including the nose. That's the padachad. Enough. The Rashash bring a diuk that's kol ha-metzach, the entire. But they Chatam Sofer in Eben Ha'ezer, chapter 2, and many more have expansion, Shev Shmaitzer, and many more on the sugya. Tashma, en meidim ela al parzuf panim chotem. That's a painful braita. We learn it in the Mishnah, in Yevomet 120. You have the issue of deserted wife or agunot, that the rabbis try to go lenient as much as we can. They have rachmanus on her. She, those women, wants to have children, wants to build a home or whatever it is. They want to have their lives together, and is unknown. So what you go? So en meidin ela al parzuf panim im hachotem. We learn it in, as we said, we learn it in the Moen Yevomis. And they said that you recognize the approver and you allow her to go ahead and marry someone based on a testimony that you see the countenance of the face with the nose. As this allow one to identify the individual definitely. So tnei ad achotem. So again, use the term up to the nose. Which means if the witnesses see only the face from the top part of the head at the beginning of the nose, which means only the forehead, so that's sufficient to take their testimony and potentially accept it. Tashma padachat belo parzuf panim belo chadachat, en meidin ad shinir'u shnehem im achotem. You need to both. V'amar Rabbeye v'iteima Rav Kahana Maikra'a, how do you know you need to see the entire face? So this is from the prophet Isaiah, chapter 3, verse 9. They said, Hakarat Pneihem Anta Bam. The recognition of the countenance does witness against them. And there is no recognition of a face without the nose. Now, obviously, the prophet Isaiah talk about the nation, but you can derive from the figurative to the literal meaning. So, Kodshei David, based on Tosfot, Dibur HaMatchil, Maikra'a, is opposite the Rashi. We said that you need the Padachat, not only the Panim. But both of them said that you need both, basically. They need padachat and need panim. Anyway, the literal text, as we said, talk about adultery and things like that. That you recognize the faces of the kids by the behavior of the parents. That the HaKadosh Baruch Hu, the Almighty, make their face. That's one of the fascination. So you recognize that it came out of adultery and therefore discover their guilt. So in my response, Shana Yidut Isha Dachmiru Barabanan. When it's come to this, the enable testimony that enable a woman to go ahead and remarry, it's very different. The sages were stringent, meaning they require greater proof than regard to halachot of a firstborn. In general, as we said, when the leniency, edechad, sometimes non-Jew and more, but here, comparing to firstborn, so it's different story, it's much stringent. Umiachmiru, is that true? V'atnan learned the Mishnah in Yevamot 1:22. הוחזיקו להיות מסיעים עד מפי עד, מפי אישה, מפי עבד, מפי שפחה. Which means that the sages established that they allow women to marry again based on a testimony that is generally not accepted, such as the testimony of an heresy, which is the testimony of one man, which was heard from another who saw the, her husband, from woman's testimony, from Canaanite servant testimony, or from a Canaanite maid servant testimony. So the Gemara answers and is saying, כי אכילו רבנן בסופה, בתחילתה לא אכילי. The sages, at the end of the testimony, to accept testimony that a husband had died, even from individual, we just said, but not the beginning, the basic clarification of whether the witness properly identified the head person when they saw him. V'ibaiteima, if you wish, you can say instead that Rabbi Yochanan can resolve the difficulty as follow. Page 47. Yakir lechud v'hakarat panim lechud. The requirement of, quote, he shall recognize with regard to a firstborn for inheritance, that's one category, one thing, and recognition of a husband's face are total discrete matter, total different. So the Shev Shmaitzer, and you see it also Tosfot Yom Tov, explained on the difference between the two Perushim. I would like to show with you, just as a conclusion, a few words from the we learn in the Gemara that the firstborn son is basically befitting to receive double portion. But that specifically applies to a son that you recognize. Ki et habechor yakir, the Torah said in Dvarim 21, verse 17. And the big machloket between Rabbi Yochanan and Resh Lakish is when you see the metzach, the forehead, if that's enough. So basically the halacha follows Rabbi Yochanan, that the moment you see the forehead of the fetus, that's sufficient. But when it's come to inheritance, it's a machloket, it's a disputation among the rabbis, especially if it wasn't a natural delivery, the C-section and things like that. The Beit Ephraim hold that when the most part of the fetus came out, it's already considering delivered, and he deserved to get double portion. But Marit Al-Ghazi, he says that the very basic condition is to be bar hakara, that you recognize that. And as long as you don't see the forehead, you can't have din b'chor because you can't recognize it. And so, only if the father recognizes his son, so then he's considering a b'chor. Otherwise, it's not. But obviously, as we said, that's the machloket between the Beit Ephraim and Marit Al-Ghazi. Maybe one day we can expand on that.